All right, it's Market Monday time. Thanks for stopping in. This week, we talked about the fact that houses are staying on the market a little bit longer. Currently, real estate agents aren't able to pay the rent for their offices. Interest rates dropped a little bit this week. The market, more of the same. Low inventory, low sales. This week, Market Mondays with Craig Lehman. What do we need to know about these Bluffton numbers this week, Craig?
You know, nothing surprising for me, Dan. Like you said, appreciation a little bit higher.
It's really high, right? We're talking about 28% year over year.
Right.
You know, looking back at 2021, the first half of 2021 was really strong, slowed down a little bit in the second half. So we're comparing to the slower second half of 2021. That's a lot of appreciation.
And you know, last week was a little slow in terms of under contract.
Yep. But inventory, super slow. So 23 properties came on the market last week, compared to 58 the same week last year.
Well,
right? So sales have to slow down, right? Yeah. If there's nothing out there to buy. So the one thing that I talk about every show is I look at, when I get these numbers, I look at the number of properties that came on the market, 23, and I look at the number of properties that went under contract. So this is now the second week in Bluffton, not in a row, but the second week in Bluffton where we've seen less properties sell than came on the market. Not a dramatic amount, but a little bit. So keep an eye on that. That could show some imbalance coming in the future, but it's not enough that it's outpacing the weeks that are ahead. So an article in Yahoo about 37% of real estate agents in the U.S. couldn't afford to pay their rent. You know, digging into that article, what they mean is the rent on their offices.
Correct. Well, you know, when I read an article like that, the first thing I think of is, like anybody, I feel bad for any business that suffered, right?
Yeah.
But it's really hard for me to relate to that because the market that I know, we're pretty happy where we are this year. This last 2 weeks, our small group has written 5 contracts that would include listings. That's 8 and 10 in the last 2 months.
And are these like savvy investors that are coming in to,
it's a great point.
To like take out like mom and pops, or are these just regular people? Like what, who are these people?
They're astute buyers, which is key. They're cash buyers. You know, I'm bullish on the low country for 2023. It is a sought after area to live in. The state is spectacular. All the things we know, but most importantly, we're probably a little more resilient to interest rate. You know, we have cash buyers, and if you sold that home anywhere in the country, how long do you wait? Especially when you look at the inventory, if they're astute and they say, how's this gonna crash when there's so little inventory? I think what they're slowing down is what you refer to, is there's not as much product. But at the same time, they don't have to pay. They can take their time. It's not as frantic as we saw in 2020.
I think there's going to be areas and states that just do well. There is a pretty significant shift of people from northeastern states, from states out west, to states like Florida, Texas, South Carolina, Georgia. You know, a lot of people have moved to those places and taken properties that were investment properties and turned those into primary residence, right? That's why there's less product to buy in those areas.
You know, so many of these markets that I look at in these publications, and they don't have the diversity that we have. They don't have a retirement buyer. They don't have an oceanfront of rental buyer. They don't have, you know, you look what's happened to our area since we've been here a long time. Look at the diversity that's just taken place in Bluffton. I mean, we've got a workforce now that often lives in Savannah. Some of them actually now are doing the reverse to me. They're working in Beaufort and living in Bluffton.
Sure.
So we have so much more to offer than what so many of these communities that, where I'm assuming some of these numbers are more impactful.
Completely agree. So Zillow Research put out an article, and if you don't follow Zillow Research, everybody out there that's interested in real estate, Zillow Research pages on their website, there's unbelievable amounts of data there. Most people don't even know it's there, but they came out and they said houses are staying on the market longer. Now their measure is a little bit different than the traditional measure of days on the market that we use, right? What our MLS and what most MLSs measure is the moment a property comes on the market until it goes under contract.
Right.
Zillow measures how long it's on Zillow.
Right.
So that can sometimes be through closing, right? So if during the pandemic, the market was moving so fast that things were closing in 2 to 3 weeks, and now it's taking 6 weeks, that's adding to the Zillow number, wouldn't necessarily add to the numbers that we're looking at. So is it taking longer for houses to sell now? I mean, we just talked about the numbers. It's down. Last year at this time, it was 67 days. It's down to 39, so not quite cut in half. But it seems like things are taking longer to sell. What do we see?
Yeah, I think so, too. I mean, that's what the numbers don't lie. But it's but again, we're comparing so much of this against 2021. I mean, 2021 is a year that I've never seen in my lifetime. And I've seen some great athletes come out of Hilton Head. Compare them to all pro NFL players. I mean, 2021 is spectacular.
Yeah, what's your benchmark?
Right, what's your benchmark? So we know when 68 days on the market, we've lived through these, when 68 days on the market, not very, pretty good.
Yeah.
I mean, but again, 2021, pretty hard comparison.
Yeah. In this article, you know, one of the things that they're talking about that's affecting that is because we're not getting as much inventory, fresh inventory coming on the market. If somebody's been in this market a while, they know that you have this opportunity right at the beginning of the listing to sell it. And if you don't sell it right away, it tends to drag on its price reductions, right? So what the Zillow article is saying is we're not getting as much property coming on the market right now that's selling instantly.
Right.
And so that's making the days on the market look stretched out. It's really more an effect of the fact that we're not getting as much new inventory.
Also, what I'm seeing is sellers are still sometimes thinking it's still 2021.
Yeah.
Where aggressive pricing, the market moved to those prices a lot in 2021. We have to be sharp. They have to be realistic in where we are today. It's not going to move up. We've got to come out of the blocks with a really good market price.
Yeah. I mean, we've all heard the term distress selling, right?
Mm-hmm.
Seller that's in distress, they have to sell.
Right.
I think the pandemic created a distressed buyer,
right.
The buyer that had to buy, right? And so it caused them to, in some instances, pay anything. And it probably artificially inflated some numbers in some markets because of that unrelenting demand to get out of wherever they were held up,
mm-hmm.
to a place where they could quarantine on the beach, so to speak, right? Mortgage. We're not going to have our normal mortgage minute. The Mortgage Network couldn't make it today, but there's an article that says home buyer demand picks up again as mortgage rates retreat below 7%. I think we as real estate agents have made such a big deal out of mortgage rates when they were low. Then mortgage rates went up and we said to everybody, hey, don't worry about it. It's no big deal. Are we going to make the same mistake that when they go back down, we're going to be like, now's your time, when we were just telling people it didn't matter?
What do you think?
I think that whatever a mortgage rate is what it is, and you live your life.
Right?
You live your life. Everybody's playing the same game, and when rates go down and there's an opportunity, you refinance.
You said something the other day that my thought was similar. The most mistakes I've made in my life, when I made a decision that wasn't based on a long-term decision.
Sure.
And if I'm coming to this area, and if I know I'm coming to this area, do I make a short-term decision and hold off because I want to come here and just keep waiting and waiting and waiting? Or is this part of my long-term plan? Because again, I'm bullish on the area. And I think, you know, that's what we see from astute buyers.
Yeah.
You know, they understand what's going on in the market. They've been good through markets that are good and bad.
Yeah, and if they're cash, they don't care.
Exactly.
So another question, a little crystal ball question. How much do you think prices are going to appreciate the next year? About.
We're in the same thinking that you are. We think it's going to appreciate up, and we're saying excess of 10%. We think it'll be a little bit higher than the average in the state, but we're pretty high on the state as well.
So let's say it's 10%.
Right.
What's a low interest rate?
I've had interest rates over 8% in my life, so I think a good interest rate's around 6%.
Okay.
But what do you think?
Well, I mean, you know, people are hoping that we get back to 3 or 3.5, right? So let's say 3. And they're at what, 6.5 right now?
Right.
So we're talking 3.5%. So to save 3.5%, you'll wait a year and have prices go up by 10%?
Right. Doesn't make sense.
Doesn't make any sense, mm-hmm. right? And that's why I have bought some things over the last couple of years that I paid absolutely top of market for, and now they're worth double. It's all about playing the long game. Buying something that's solid fundamentally. You know, I think Warren Buffett is the prime example of that investor in our country. He's bought some things at a time where you'd be like, why wouldn't he buy that now? Why wouldn't he wait? And he bought it because they were a good company,
right.
And they had good fundamentals, and he believed,
right.
in the long term they would be good investments.
Right.
Now, real estate is a little different, right? It can be a good investment, and you can build memories in it too. And so my advice is find the thing that you want,
mm-hmm.
and then buy it, not with the plan to sell it in 2 years.
Yeah, you're almost becoming a life coach, aren't you? I mean, you, exactly.
Well, I mean, and how you're long are you going to wait?
How long are you going to wait?
Mailbag. So the first one has a little bit of expletive. We'll bleep that out. But Josh V asked, hello, Dan. I was wondering if you had any good recommendations for a van to buy, because I'll be living out of a bleeping van if this market doesn't crash in the next 8 months. First of all, Josh, I'm sorry if, you know, financially you're under pressure. I mean, I truly am, and I don't mean to make light out of it, but the market is not going to crash here, Josh. So if you're asking me here locally, when is the market going to crash? It's not going to. So I would make some different contingency plans and figure something out. I think our best hope is that they get inflation under control and the cost of your housing is going to be higher than it was, but hopefully the cost of other things can go down and we can help raise people's incomes.
Yeah, well said. We all have to learn how to make it in this business despite the markets, but I don't see the market crashing.
Allison H. asks, hey Dan, how safe of an investment is buying a short-term rental property on Hilton Head Island in this market? And is it better to buy turnkey or not? So first question, how safe of an investment is it?
Boy, that's a tough question, right? Without asking her a lot more questions on that, you know, is she really looking at, is it solely as an investment, or is she looking at intrinsic value? Is she gonna live in it, have a place, offset some of her second home ownerships? When, you know, there's a lot of good investments out there that are gonna—
Sure.
But if you want, like you said, if you wanna live in it, create memories, there's still opportunities out there. And the mortgage rates does make a little difference in that than—
Yep.
On that. So if you're a cash buyer and you're patient, I still think about it. You have to dig a little harder.
I think if it's a true investment and you are not using the property for family and to build memories, like Craig said, I think there's other investments out there that are better. And they can be real estate. The problem is if you put all of your eggs in one basket with any investment, that's not a good move. So you'd be better to buy into like a real estate trust where you're diversifying your money across commercial property and vacation homes and all of that stuff. That would be a safer, just pure investment. But you know, if you're going to use the property and build memories, is it safe? Yeah, if you're going to be in this market for at least 5 years, I don't think you can go wrong, right? It's all about the time horizon, in my opinion. And is it better to buy turnkey or not? Your answer to that?
Well, as Mike says all the time, as you look at if you look at what's selling right now in this market, a well-priced turnkey home does not stay on the market. So turnkey would be my— And also, it's a little hard to find right now. Supplies still in this market, builders, and going through that process.
My answer to it, Allison, would be the same as the first part of your question, is it depends. If you buy a turnkey property and overpay for it by 15%, that is not a good investment. If you buy a turnkey property and pay market value, that's a good investment. If you buy a property that needs work and you get a 25% discount on it, and to fix it up is gonna cost you less than that 25%, well, clearly that's a better investment. And so again, this is the problem with real estate. If you go to your stockbroker and there's Home Depot stock for sale and you don't buy it today and somebody else does, there'll be more Home Depot stock tomorrow and it's exactly the same stock. But if you see a property that you like today and you don't buy it and somebody else does, you're gonna end up having to buy something different, right? And real estate is not a commodity. As much as we want to think about it that way, it's just not. And so what's a good investment is very specific, and it's why the best advice I can give you is to connect with somebody that understands the investment in this area and can help put you in the right investment for you. Because what could be a great investment for one person paying cash could be a horrible investment for another person that needs finance. So man, thanks for coming in. Thanks for your opinions on the market. Keep coming.